Last time we talked about a title that I really love and that you're familiar with, that the Savior uses of himself quite frequently in Scripture. And that for me is a good way to symbolize and epitomize these last moments in the Passion Play. And that is, I am the beginning and the end. But as I told you, I like to reverse it. I am the ending and the beginning. And we talked about the ending last time, the ending certainly of his life on the cross, the finishing of his Father's will, but also the promise that he gives, that his words, "It is finished," gives to us. And the reiteration of that promise in the book of Revelation, that grief, sorrow, pain, suffering come to an end, and that all of us will also be able to say it is finished of our own griefs. We will watch the Savior then be removed from the cross. The Passion Play does that quite movingly. There aren't really a lot of scriptures that go with it. We are told that Joseph of Arimathea goes to Pilate and begs the body of Jesus, and Pilate grants him the body, and Jesus is then buried in the grave of Joseph of Arimathea, which was very close by Calvary. And now we wait to see what the beginning is. If he is the ending, he's also the beginning. And maybe I would just say, as we begin to look at that, if you ask the question, what is he the beginning of? I think you probably will have many words that you could answer. He would say, I am the beginning of life. I am the beginning of peace. I am the beginning of rest. I am the beginning of forgiveness. I am the beginning of healing. I am the beginning of joy and reunion and happiness. I am the end of all sorrows, and I am the beginning of all joys. And there is a moment at the end of the Passion Play. And I would just warn you at this juncture that the resurrection is very quick. The Passion Play is going to end. And for a lot of you, it's going to be, whoa, that was fast. It's going to be just very, very quick. Remember, the different religious groups as different individuals have connecting places at different areas of the Savior's life. And the crucifixion and the carrying of the cross and the scourging is the Catholic primary connecting place. If you're Orthodox, you would feel, you would wonder a little bit where the celebratory joy of the resurrection is. So it is a very short scene at the end, on resurrection morning. There is not a living image that goes with it. He is placed in the tomb. It's a moving scene, but it will be over quite quickly. So I'm going to try and fill it out a little bit more and maybe give you some other thoughts as you watch that last moment, the resurrection Sunday morning. The story that they choose to depict is Mary Magdalene. Now they're going to change it a little bit. They won't have they may do it different this year, but in the past, Mary Magdalene's conversation with the angel grabs some of the statements that Jesus gives to her. I think they do it for dramatic impact, but that conversation is so tender and sweet between Mary and Jesus at the tomb. Is the angel and Mary. So let me take you to John chapter 20, to resurrection morning, Mary Magdalene coming to the tomb with the other women. Now in the Matthew and Mark accounts, there are multiple women that are coming to the tomb. In John's account, Mary Magdalene takes the star central role. There is a plural, but referring to all the women, but Mary Magdalene is the main one. Now, if I had to pick a moment that really represents the turning, the change from the end of something on Calvary to the beginning of something all those things we talked about, he was the end of, and all those things he talked about, he was the beginning of. I would say that moment comes in a very dramatic, beautiful, powerful spot in John chapter 20, a very intimate moment. I think it's appropriate that it's an intimate moment, because the relationship we want most to have with Christ is that one-on-one intimate one. And this will take place between Mary and Jesus. In a sense, Mary's going to represent all of us. Now, they're going to do it differently at the Passion Play, unless they change it from past years. For dramatic effect, Jesus comes back out in the light at the very end, resurrected, but you don't have this interchange between Mary and Jesus. It's between Mary and the angel. So let's talk about how it really happened in John chapter 20, and then we'll see what they do with it this time around. Mary comes early to the tomb. They're wondering who's going to roll the stone away. They see that the stone is rolled away. Mary Magdalene runs to tell Peter and John. I'm condensing this story because you're not going to see a lot of this part. Peter and John run to the tomb. They both go in the tomb. John simply says he sees the grave clothes lying there and that he believes that Jesus is raised from the dead. Had somebody carried the body away, the implication is they would have carried the winding clothes with them. And now Peter and John leave Mary alone. And I don't know that I've ever been able to read this with a tone tender enough to carry the power of what John's writing here. But I'm going to pick it up in John chapter 20, verse 11. Mary stood without at the sepulcher weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulcher. Now maybe maybe she sees light from the angels that she's going to see in there. Maybe it's just a normal human reaction. She knows he's not in there. She's looked in there, but you just look one more time. It's like I lose my keys and I'll go back to my pocket five times even though I know it's not there. So it may be something very, very human that Mary is doing in stooping and looking in. And seeth two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. And they say unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? She saith unto them, Because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing and knew not that it was Jesus. I just want you to, for a second, let Mary represent, Mary Magdalene, in a sense, represent all of the griefs, the pains that all people might feel in life. And the empty tomb represents that, in a sense. For some people, the empty tomb is, and it is, it's a victory. He is not here. He is risen. Why seek ye the living among the dead? But when Mary looks into the empty tomb, it represents the emptiness of her heart. This man she loved, believed in, had such hopes for, who she witnessed cruelly die, and now she can't have what you and I might call closure, the final anointing of the body. And somehow for me, Mary just represents that woman's soul of hers holding so much pain and sorrow and grief. And we're going to watch in three beautiful words and the calling of her name, she's just going to shift. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, saith unto him, Sir, if thou have borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. And Jesus saith unto her, Mary. Now there's something in the voice, there's something in that personal calling of the name. She knows that voice. Maybe some of my favorite words in the whole New Testament. Three little words. She turned herself. She turned from the empty tomb to the living Christ. You know, all of us have empty tombs in our lives. I have my empty tomb. I'm sure many of you have your empty tombs. Whatever those empty tombs represent, we know from the cross that we're going to say it's finished one time. And here that is like a second witness, a second testimony to that great truth of the Savior's life. She turned herself from the empty tomb to the living Christ, and she saith unto him, Master. And I believe sooner or later in all of our lives, we're going to have what we might call the Mary Master moment. And I think this is an unscripted, spontaneous act. It's Jesus again, so concerned with everybody else. He has to ascend to his Father. He tells Mary, I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go tell my brethren, I ascend to my God and my Father and your Father. That's a fairly important ascending to do, to go to the Father and tell him, I've accomplished the atonement, the resurrection. Your will I finish, but a woman is weeping. And it isn't in Jesus' nature to leave her weeping. And so he stops long enough. Mary, Master. And then he says, hold me not. As though she could. I have to ascend to my Father. As though she could keep him there. Hold me not. I must ascend to my Father. I just again love the turning she turned herself. My favorite talk, if I can get through it, Easter sermon, I read it quite frequently because, as a number of you know, I have my own empty tomb. I lost my Laurie, my wife, 11 years ago. And I think about her every day. And I often turn to this talk when I think about that. It was given by a religious leader by the name of Joseph B. Worthlin. It was his Easter sermon, and he called it That Bright Sunday Morning. And I'd like to just share part of that with you that I think will hopefully express how I feel about this. She turned herself. I think of how dark that Friday was when Christ was lifted up on the cross. The earth shook and grew dark. Those evil men who sought his life rejoiced. On that day, the veil of the temple was rent in twain. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, were both overcome with grief. The superb man they had loved and honored hung lifeless upon the cross. The apostles were devastated. Jesus, their Savior, the man who had walked on water and raised the dead, was himself at the mercy of wicked men. It was a Friday filled with devastating, consuming sorrow. I think that of all the days since the beginning of the world's history, that Friday was the darkest. But the despair did not linger, because on Sunday, the resurrected Lord burst the bounds of death. And in an instant, that she turned herself. And in an instant, the eyes that had been filled with ever-flowing tears dried. The lips that had whispered prayers of distress and grief now fill the air with wondrous praise. For Jesus, the Christ, stood before them as proof that death is merely the beginning of a new and wondrous existence. Each of us will have our own Fridays, what I call our empty tombs. Each of us will have our own Fridays, those days when the universe itself seems shattered and the shards of our world lie littered about us in pieces. But I testify to you, I'm sorry. In the name of the one who conquered death, Sunday will come. In the darkness of our sorrows, Sunday will come. No matter our grief, Sunday will come. In this life or the next, Sunday will come. No matter how dark our Fridays may be, Sunday will come. And we will turn, as Mary did, from the empty tomb to the living Christ. One day I will hear, as one day you will hear, whatever your empty tomb may be. One day I will hear Jesus call my voice, Michael. And I will turn, and Laurie will be standing there, and it will be over. And I will say, Master. It is the great gift among the many, many gifts that he gives to us. And I would hope that at that moment in the Passion Play when we don't get that interchange, I'm sorry to tell you that. Maybe they'll do it, but he will come up in the light and everybody, all the cast are holding candles. It's a very beautiful, beautiful moment. I hope you will realize that your Sunday morning will come. All of our Sunday mornings will come. And sometimes when I am that moment and I see the Savior coming back up, it's the end of the Passion Play. It's usually they're singing. There are other moments in the Savior's resurrected life that they haven't included, that I like to put in my own mind as I look at that being and realize almost as though I can hear him saying to me certain promises. Here is what Matthew ends with. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have committed you. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. That's the ending of Matthew, and I can just hear Jesus from the stage. I hope you will reaching right into my heart and saying to me, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. And then my mind always reverts to Luke's story. Luke picks a story to almost be a testimony to Matthew's words of two disciples, not the big names, not Peter and Andrew or Nathaniel or Philip, just two disciples, one of them named Cleophas. In Luke 24, when they're on the road to Emmaus, I think you probably all know this story. Let me just share a little bit with us. Two of them went that day. I love this because they're just two ordinary people, just like you and me. Went that same day to the village called Emmaus, and they talked together of all these things which had happened. Maybe when the Passion Play is over, you will talk together with your spouse and friends of all that had happened, his whole life, but especially the last part of it. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. I hope that will happen for you. As you talk about what you've seen, that you'll feel him draw near to you and went with them. But their eyes were holden that they should not know him. And he said unto them, what manner of communications are these that ye have one to another as ye walk and are sad? And one of them, whose name was Cleophas, answered, saying, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem, and hast not known the things which are come to pass there in these days? And he said unto them, what things? And that little question is an opportunity for them to do what I, a certain kind of prayer, a certain kind of worship. I call it the pouring out. Sometimes I think God just says, what's in your heart? Pour it out. What things are you talking about? Is there fear in your heart? Is there guilt? Is there shame? Is there gratitude or joy? Is there grief, sorrow? Is there pain? What things? Tell them to me. And they tell him. And then he opens up the scriptures. It would have been the Old Testament. As we've seen all through the Passion Play, references to the Old Testament. And he teaches them out of the Old Testament the truths about his life and the need for him to do what he did. And as they get to Emmaus, they ask him if he would come in with them, and he does. He went in to tarry with them, and he took bread and blessed it and brake and gave to them, and their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way and while he opened to us the scriptures? I hope that as you look at the Savior at the very, very end, you'll hear him give that same kind of promise, that same assurance. I will be with you always, and I will walk with you. And you won't always know that I'm walking with you. You won't always, your eyes may be holding, you won't always see. You'll feel your hearts burn within you. I hope your hearts will burn within you as you witness these last parts of his life in the Passion Play. I think of that as I watch him standing on the stage, that promise that on my own roads to Emmaus, my own journeys in the world, from time to time he will come and he will walk with me and he will walk with you. Now I want to just take us back and end in the Gospel of John. John gives us three appearances of Jesus in the resurrection. Luke gives us that wonderful one on the road to Emmaus. John gives us the Mary Magdalene, that Mary Master moment. He also gives us the moment with Thomas. And sometimes at the end of the play, I will think of Thomas and view myself as having the same experience as Thomas had. Remember, Jesus appears to all the disciples, and Thomas isn't there. And poor Thomas, you know, he's we got John the Beloved and Peter the Rock and the Sons of Thunder and all nicknames Jesus gave, but mankind gave Thomas his name, Doubting Thomas. Poor Thomas, we remember him at the worst moment of his life. I like to think of a moment when Thomas said to the other disciples when Jesus was going to Jerusalem and they fully expected he would be killed. And Thomas said, let us go with him that we may die with him. That's devoted Thomas. I think that's a better name than Doubting Thomas. But anyway, he's not there and he says, except I feel, see in his hands the print of the nails and put my finger into the print of the nails and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. So 8 days later, Jesus comes back and Thomas is there. And Jesus gives an invitation. The doors being shut, Jesus stood in the midst and said, peace be unto you. Then saith he to Thomas, reach hither thy finger and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. Now, I believe that all of us one day are going to have that kind of an experience. There are precedents in Scripture of Jesus sometimes asking whole multitudes to come and touch the tokens of his atonement. And sometimes in those last moments of the Passion Play, I visualize myself as Thomas, and I can hear him say, Michael, come forward. and touch the tokens of my atonement and know of my love for you. Now, I have given those names. This is just me. This is nobody else. It's me interacting with the Savior's life and this moment at the end of the Passion Play, which ends a little too quickly for me. And I'm trying to draw it out a little bit by thinking of other moments in the Scriptures with the resurrected Lord. If I were Thomas, and I walked up on that stage, and he said to me, "Michael, you know, the first one that often Jesus asks people to touch is the side." Now, I have never seen a painting of that. I've never seen a dramatic depiction of it. But I call the token in his side the token of intimacy. Can you imagine how you would feel if you were Thomas? And thrusting, it doesn't mean into the wound. It means you lay your hand inside his cloak, his robe, and you lay that hand. You lay that hand right on his heart, because that's where the spear thrust went, right on his heart. It is the token of intimacy. It is an invitation of Jesus to all of us to share that intimate, deep relationship. And there is a song, there are Christian songs I put with all three of those scars of his atoning sacrifice. This is the one that I have for this one. Oh, love effulgent, love divine, what debt of gratitude is mine, that in his offering I have part and hold a place within his heart, a token of intimacy. And then we would look at his hands. Thomas looks at his hands. I call them the token of wonder, the token of submission. And there is again a Christian song, that for me, captures the moment that you would, as you looked at the hands. Now, there's a lot of paintings of looking at the hands. Like I say, I've never seen one of a hand touching the side. But there's a lot of the hands, and I look at the hands and I think of these words from I Stand All Amazed. I think of his hands pierced and bleeding to pay the debt. Such mercy, such love and devotion can I forget. Oh, it is wonderful that he should care for me enough to die for me. Oh, it is wonderful, wonderful to me. The tokens of wonder. Now, if I were Thomas, if I really could go right up on that stage and have that intimate time with him, after the side and the hands, I don't think I could stand on my feet. Do you think you could? I think I would fall at his feet. And we would weep. And now we would see the third token. I call this the token of adoration. There is a difference between gratitude and adoration, between thanksgiving and praise. Adoration and praise are grateful for the giver of the gift. Thanksgiving and gratitude focus on the gift. Thanksgiving and gratitude says, "Thank you, Lord, for the beautiful world." Adoration and praise say, "What must the being be like who can create such wonders?" God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Adoration focuses on the giver of the gift and the love of that gift. And so the wounds in the feet I call the token of adoration. And maybe one of the greatest Christian hymns ever written, I think of when I picture myself as Thomas there at the feet of Jesus. It's the hymn, "How Great Thou Art." And when I think that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. Token of intimacy, token of wonder, token of adoration. Maybe those thoughts can come into your mind and you'll be Thomas, or you'll be the disciples on the road to Emmaus, and you'll hear him say to you those assurances that he will be with us always. Now, John, in his gospel, seems like he's ending it in chapter 20 with that moment with Thomas. He ends it with the words, many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. Doesn't that sound like a conclusion? That sounds to me like he's finished. And maybe he did. Maybe it was a year later. Maybe it was that he goes back and he says, no, I need to add one more witness of the living Christ. Because the Passion Play, in a lot of ways, focuses on the dying Christ. But John focuses on the end on the living Christ, not only living in his life and the parables and the teachings he's taught that we talked about in our first three sessions, but the living Christ after. So Mary Magdalene's testimony, Thomas's testimony, and now we have the scene on the Sea of Galilee with Jesus and Peter and a very beautiful conversation. The third witness in John's gospel of the resurrection. So he adds one more chapter, John 21. And Peter, he's a little lost. He's denied him. I'm sure he's still troubled by that. Now, he's already seen Jesus by this time. But he finally says, they're back up in Galilee. I go a-fishing. And some of the other disciples say, we go with you. James and John were there, I'm sure. We're told the sons of Zebedee were there. Nathaniel's there. Thomas is there. Two other disciples, probably Andrew and Philip. And they all go out and they fish all night. They don't catch anything. And as they're coming back into the shore, Jesus is standing on the shore. He's got a little coal of fire there, a little fire of coals. And he calls to them, have you caught anything? And they fished all night and they've caught nothing. And he says, cast your nets on the right side and you will find. And they do, and 153 big fish come into it. Now, John remembers this is the first miracle that Jesus does at the Sea of Galilee when he calls Peter, James, and John, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. He multiplies their catch after they fished all night. So he's duplicating the miracle he did when he first called him to follow him, because he's going to ask them to follow again. And John remembers. And John says to Peter, it is the Lord. And Jesus and Peter wraps his fisherman's cloak around him and he dives into the sea, so eager to be with the Savior, and swims to shore and pulls the net in. And they have a little breakfast. And then when they're done, Jesus and Peter take a little walk down the seashore. And John follows a little bit behind him. We know they're walking because the word following, John followed, was there. And Jesus asks Peter some questions. Now, when you look at Jesus again on the stage, the resurrected Lord, you might hear him ask you this question. So when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? I don't know what the these refer to. Some think it's the fish they've caught. Some, do you love me more than you love the disciples? Do you love me more than the disciples love me? I can't answer that. The important question is, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my lambs. He saith to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, feed my sheep. Maybe you will hear that conversation. Sometimes at the end, I try to get all these into my mind as that last part of the Passion Play comes. The Savior says to you, and he says to me, Michael, lovest thou me? And it is such a glorious thing to be able to say, to answer that question, especially after you've seen those moments in his life. I feel that way every time I read the Gospels and I come to the very last chapter of the Gospels and that last great question, lovest thou me? And I always read that as though he's asking it to me. Every time I take people to Israel and we walk on that north shore of the Sea of Galilee where this took place, I try and get a little time alone so I can walk and feel him asking me that question. And the great joy it is for all of us to be able to say, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. At that moment of the Passion Play, I hope you'll feel him near. And I hope you'll feel that question. And I hope you'll answer it. And I hope that your experience preparing for the Passion Play and seeing it will help you answer that question with greater and greater intensity. And so I just conclude with going back to Matthew, something the angels said to the women at the tomb. They said, I know ye seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, he is risen. Come see the place where the Lord lay. And so I would say to you those words of the angels, I know why you're coming to the Passion Play. I know why you're going to Oberammergau. I mean, you're going to have other experiences, but I know why you're going. You seek Jesus, who was crucified. And it is my sincere hope and wish and my most fervent prayer that you will find him there, that the results of your search will be all that you anticipate and expect them to be. That you will find him in Oberammergau, and that you will find him all through your life's journey. May that be the gift God gives to you for your seeking, is my humble wish for you. And I thank you for letting me share these thoughts with you and prepare you for the Passion Play. And may it be all you hope it to be. Thank you.